गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, वेलकम टू मैथमेटिक्स क्लास 11। आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट चैप्टर 8, मैथमेटिकल इंडक्शन, एंड वी आर गोइंग टू कवर द होल चैप्टर इन टू वीडियोस, इन विच फर्स्ट पार्ट इज इंट्रोडक्शन टू प्रिंसिपल ऑफ मैथमेटिकल इंडक्शन एंड एप्लीकेशंस बेस्ड ऑन वेरियस समेशंस। So in this part, first we will understand what is mathematical induction, then we will try some questions based on it. So let's get started. Now, first of all, we will understand what is inductive reasoning and deductive reasoning so that we can clearly understand the meaning of induction. When a person makes observation, experiments and trial, and on their basis reaches a conclusion, then this is known as inductive reasoning. So first, on the basis of observations we are reaching a conclusion, or on the basis of different trials we are reaching to a conclusion. But on the other hand, when a person proceeds from certain assumptions, let this be true, let that be true, only then the proofs are done rather than experience. So it is usually by inductive reasoning that mathematical results are discovered, and by this method they are proved. That means this is done by experiment and this is done by theoretical proofs. So by inductive reasoning, mathematical results are discovered, and then by deductive reasoning, by certain assumptions, they are proved forever. Let us take a simple example of triangles. By drawing a number of triangles, see, right angle triangle, obtuse angle triangle, acute, isosceles, equilateral. The number of triangles I have drawn, and if I take consideration of sum of all the angles, the sum is going to be 180 degree, more or less. This is also going to be 180. This is also 180, 180 degree and 180 degree. While drawing, I have not measured any angle other than this. I do not know the measures of these angles, these angles, all these angles and so on. Still, if I measure them, the sum of angles of a triangle will be equal to 180, or nearly it will be 179 point something, or it can be 180 point something near, because exact values we can never measure. We cannot measure the angles with absolute accuracy, and our measurements are likely to vary by a degree or two. So it does not matter, but when we tried drawing different types of triangles and by adding up all the angles with certain accuracy, not exact, we found that the sum is coming nearly 180. So what was it? This was an experiment or an observation. We have drawn some random triangles. These are just 5 in numbers. While doing this discovery, the number of triangles must be more. So while doing this, we got the sum to be nearly 180. So this was the discovery of inductive reasoning. Now the deductive reasoning was, we have actually with some assumptions proved that some of the angles of a triangle is actual 180. So now you understand the difference between inductive and deductive reasoning. In inductive, we make certain experiments, we make certain trials, observations, and see whether the particular thing is true for all or not. If it is true for all, we prove it with some assumptions. So in inductive reasoning, the mathematical results are discovered like this, and by deductive reasoning they are proved. This is theoretical part, this is experimental part. So let us see in terms of numbers. Let us take one more example. Let's say 2n. So inductive reasoning says, put any value of n. let's check for n equals to 1, this is 2n is 2. For n equals to 2, 2n will be 4. N equals to 3, 2n will be 6, and so on. Now here the observation is, for any value of n you substitute, whether you are putting negative value, positive value or 0. Let us put one negative value also, 2n will be minus 2. Here you need to put an observation, for any value you are putting, negative, positive or 0 for n, you are always getting an even number. This is observation, or you can say this is the discovery. Then by some mathematical proofs, it has been observed that 2 multiplied with any value will always going to give me an even number. So by all the proofs, that was deductive reasoning, and this trials, observations, was inductive reasoning. Same way we have 2n plus 1 for odd number. So for any value of n you substitute here, adding 1 to it, you will always get an odd number. So again, certain experiments are done before proving this. Now let us see how principle of mathematical induction works. Now the proof of a proposition Tn. Tn here is any summation or any expression given. For example, in these two examples here, Tn is 2n and here Tn is 2n plus 1. So it depends from question to question what exact proposition they want us to prove. Now how it goes, the very first step is known as basic step. That means we have to prove certain thing by 1. We have to put n equals to 1 in basic step. Now why 1? We are just going to check for any random number, and 1 is the most easiest number to be checked. That is why we always take it to be 1. You can take it 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and so on, but then you are increasing your calculations, nothing else. So we always take basic step, any random number, to be 1. We will not take 0 because 0 is not a natural number. Alright, then second step is known as induction step. Where we put the value k in place of n, and let us assume tk is true. We will assume that if a particular proposition is true for n equal to 1, it will be true for any random value. If it is equal to n equal to 1, it will be equal to for any random value, say k. Now the third step furthermore says that if it is true for tk, we need to prove that tk plus 1 is also true. So the questions are almost based on the step. The very first step is common in all. You have to just put 1 and see whether it is verifying or not. Then in second step, you will assume that if it is true for first value, it will be true for all the values, whichever value you take. So a certain symbol we take k, and this is just assumption. Then in the third step, we will prove. So this two proof step is important. Let's check for the very first question. Applications based on summation. Prove that for all positive integral values of n, this particular proposition works. So here what will be the Tn? Let Tn be this whole statement, this whole proposition. 1 + 3 + 5 + 2n - 1 n² Okay, now step 1, basic step. We will try T1. How we will try? We will put here 1, or you can say first term. First term is 1. If not, you can put 1 here. So both ways the answer will be same. 2 into 1, 2 minus 1, 1. So first term is 1, because this is belonging to the same summation. So T1 means first term is 1, and putting 1 on right hand side, we are getting 1 square, so it is true. Basic step is only this much. Step 2. Let us assume that TK is true, which means if I substitute K in the place of N, so it becomes 2K minus 1 equal to K square. Now step 3, prove that it is true for TK plus 1. So ultimately we have to prove 2K plus 1 minus 1 equals to K plus 1 whole square. Now this was K and this is K plus 1. So that means if we start, this is our proof. If I start 1 plus 3 plus 5, 2k minus 1, then it will be 2k plus 1 minus 1. I hope you have understood this step. This step, I have substituted first k minus k at step 2, and at step 3 I have substituted k plus 1. Now how this step came, if you see first term, second term, third term and last term, then first term, second term, third term, last second term will be this. That means for a random series, let us see, for example, let us see this sequence, first, second, terms, first term, second term, third, and this is the last term. So if I want to write last second term, won't I know that this is 18? Same way I have done here. If this is the last term of k plus 1, so kth term will be the second last term, and this is matching here, equation number 1. So this value k square I am substituting here, k square, using equation 1 of step 2, plus 2k plus 2 minus 1. So k square plus 2k plus 1. And if you see, this is ultimately equal to k plus 1 whole square, a square b square 2ab, which is equals to the RHS. This. So the statement is true for n equals to k plus 1 under the assumption that it is true for n equals to k. That means if it is true for n equals to k, only then it is going to be true for n equals to k plus 1. This is all about principle of mathematical induction. First step, basic, n equal to 1. Second step, induction, n equals to k, that is going to be true by assumption. And third step, we need to prove that it is true for k plus 1. Let us try some more questions for better clarity. Before we move to next question, I want to make a point clear to you. Suppose this summation 1 plus 2 plus 3 is going up to n. So can't it be 1 plus 2 plus 3 n minus 1 plus n? If the last term is n, the second last term will be 1 less than it. Like this, if this is third term is 3, the term before it is 1 less and the term before it is 1 less. So in the same way I have done minus 1. So this concept only we are using for k and k plus 1. If the last term is k plus 1, the second last term will be of k, right? So if I have taken an assumption 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to k, and in the second step I have taken the proof of k plus 1, so the second last term will be k, na? 1 less than it, and this value I am taking from second step, induction step. I hope this point is clear. Now let's proceed to second question. Prove that for all positive integral values of n, 1 upon, this is not 1.2, 1 into 2 plus 1 upon 2 into 3 till 1 upon n, n plus 1. Now how this has been generalized, this is 1, added 1 to it, we got 2. 2 and 2 plus 1, 3, same n and n plus 1. So it is this, we have to prove this by induction. So let us start with the basic step. First of all, let Tn be the statement. You have to define Tn every time you are going to start. N, n plus 1. The symbols should match. Then step 1, basic T1. So either you say T1 will be the first term, 1 by 2, and should be equal to n equal to 1 here. So this should be 1 upon 1 plus 1, which is 1 by 2. So this is true. This you have to actually prove. Then step 2, induction. These are the steps that you have to write in all the solutions. Assume TK is true. So which means 1 upon 1 into 2 plus 1 upon 2 into 3. 1 upon k plus 1 is equals to k plus 1. Equation number 1. Step 3. To prove tk plus 1 is true. Second step, we are assuming that it is true for k. In third step, we have to prove that for the next term. If it is true for k, it has to be true for k plus 1. That is another consecutive term. Alright, so let us write the statement for k plus 1 from here. One upon k plus 1 at the place of n k plus 1 and at the place of this n k plus 1 plus 1 k plus 1 upon k plus 1 plus 1. So this is also to prove. Now I'm taking LHS. Plus this was the LHS. Now same way, if these terms are k plus 1, the term previous to it will be 1 less k, and the consecutive term will be k plus 1. I hope this point is clear to you, how I have written this. Or you can go with the sequence also. If the last term of the summation says k plus 1 in one bracket, so k plus 1 just preceding term will be k, 1 less. Same way, if this is k plus 2, 1 less will be k plus 1. And this we will take help from the second step, which is this 1 upon k, k plus 1 will be equal to k, k plus 1. So using equation 1, I am writing this k upon k plus 1 and this as it is. Here I will write using equation 1. Now take LCM. K plus 2, k, k plus 2 plus 1. So k square plus 2k plus 1 upon k plus 1 and k plus 2. Split middle term, and before we split middle term, somewhere I should write RHS also. The RHS that I want is k plus 1 and k plus 2. See, I have seen from here the RHS here. The left hand side I am proceeding with, and the RHS k plus 1, k plus 2. Alright. Okay, so split middle term and solve. So this is k plus 1 whole square. By splitting middle term, all those procedures cancel. K plus 1, k plus 2, which is equals to RHS. So that means T k plus 1 is true with the assumption that TK is true. So principle of mathematical induction works if the statement or a proposition is true for a certain number, then it will always be true for the next number, next continuous or consecutive number. So I am ending up here. I hope the concept is clear to you. And now you have to solve some questions related to summations in the first exercise 8A. So I want you to try some questions of 8A before we continue in the class. Try question number 1, 3, 4. Try these many questions. These questions are enough for practice of summations of principle of mathematical induction. So doubts we will take during the class.